knowing the position of a train on the track is of foremost importance for successful layout automation, and normally this is achieved by trackside sensors. In other words, sensors that are installed next to the track and detect data elements from trains going by. The collected information is then communicated to a control device for processing. In video number 37, I provided a classification of such sensors and listed the most common types and technologies. A completely different approach to this is train-side sensors. In the last video, I showed a simple way for measuring speed and distance using a sensor that actually rides on the train. In this video, I'm going to test whether it is possible to continuously detect and report the train position using some kind of a train-side GPS sensor. Welcome to the IoTT channel. I am Hans Tanner. The basic concept of the train-side GPS sensor is that the train can detect its own position while traveling on the layout. This information can then be used to control the train, for example, slowing down in front of a closed signal, or it can be used for illuminating block detector LEDs on a CTC panel, train identification included. And of course, all this without having to cut the rails in block sections and wiring a ton of current sensors and the like. In fact, with high enough granularity of the position feedback, even modern control concepts from prototype railroads, like for example moving blocks, would become possible. My first thought was indeed using real GPS sensors to accomplish the task. Typical GPS chips, as used in a cell phone, have an accuracy of about 16 feet, and when using a GPS RTK module, this can be improved to about 10 millimeters. RTK stands for Real-Time Kinematics. This technology uses a location-specific radio signal to improve the accuracy of the GPS timing signal and therefore calculating a more accurate location. Unfortunately, there are at least three disadvantages that made me not to explore this path further. First, the correction signal seems not to be available in all locations. Second, implementation costs. RTK boards recently dropped in price from more than $1,000 to about $250, but that is still way too much for putting a device in every train. And third, GPS only works with free sight to the skies, so it would be a costly option for garden railroads, but impossible to use for indoor layouts. Case closed, at least for the moment. In the long run, and with further price cuts, I think the RTK technology could become an interesting option for garden railroads. Now, an interesting question is, how do current GPS systems work if there is no free sight to the skies, for example, if the car is driving in a tunnel? Well, in such a situation, they make use of another sensor, which is usually found in a GPS device, and that is the Inertial Measurement Unit, or IMU. A typical IMU consists of a three-dimensional accelerometer and a three-dimensional gyroscope. Some types, in addition, include a three-dimensional magnetometer. With this armada of sensors, it is possible to measure lateral and rotational acceleration in the three primary dimensions, and with some calculation, estimate the current speed and position of the object that is attached to the IMU. In the past, IMUs have already been used in the Apollo program to control the attitude of the spacecraft. In the time since, they have been miniaturized to a small chip, which is now not only found in GPS systems, but as well in smartphones for gesture recognition, aircraft or drone autopilot systems for direction and attitude control, and hundreds of other applications where it is important to know the exact orientation of an object in relation to an external coordinate system. Another field of application is vibration analysis, as I did in video number 37, where I used an IMU to create a trackside axle counter sensor. And because of the widespread use, the cost of such chips is down to just a few bucks. For my train side sensor application, I chose the BNO055 from Bosch. Compared to other popular IMUs like the MPU6050, the BNO055 features not only the accelerometer and gyroscope sensors, but also includes an ARM Cortex M0 microcontroller that collects all the data and does the necessary processing, also called sensor fusion, to output angles for yaw, roll and pitch, which can be read using an I2C interface. Sensor fusion is actually quite a complex task. It involves reading the values of all 9 sensors and then integrate the values over time to estimate the position. This is a process that is very vulnerable to rounding errors, and integration errors add up from estimation to estimation. Therefore, a lot of filtering and correction is included in the calculation as well. If you are interested in the details, there are hundreds of scientific papers and YouTube videos covering sensor fusion of an IMU. Long story short, it is very convenient that sensors like the BNO055 do all the math on their built-in controller and just deliver the final estimation results. For Arduino applications, there is a quite powerful library available that allows for reading raw sensor data as well as the computed heading data in the form of Euler angles or quaternions with a maximum rate of 100 samples per second. So a heading angle from 0 to 360 degrees, roll angles from -180 to +180 degrees, and pitch angles from -90 to +90 degrees. In the controller software, I then perform a fusion of the Euler angle data with the motion vector provided by the magnetic sensor introduced in video number 81 to calculate a new position of the sensor within a three-dimensional coordinate system. Since the fusion frequency of the IMU is 100 Hz, a new position is calculated every 10 milliseconds. Here are the formulas in some detail. First, I use the incremental change of the axis angle to calculate the moving distance of the wheel. Once the distance is known, I calculate the horizontal and vertical components of the movement as a function of the pitch angle. In order to filter out random fluctuations of the value, I consider all movements with a slope of less than 1% as flat. In the next step, I calculate the movement components in X and Y direction. And finally, the current position is updated with the position changes. These values can be stored in a local data file on the microcontroller with a rate of 10 positions per second. So the trajectory can be analyzed after completion of the measurement. They are also sent once per second to the web app for real-time display of the movement, as we will see in a minute. In the web app itself, I added a graphic area to display the current location, as well as display fields for the current values of yaw, roll, and pitch, and a set of buttons to reset the values. I also added the possibility to directly record the data on the microcontroller and then download the data file for additional processing. All this, of course, is very temporary, as the whole sensor is experimental and the primary goal is to find out if a positioning system based on a distance sensor and an IMU can work at all. And with that implemented, it was time for an initial test. As before, I used my temporary G-scale track oval. I placed the sensor in the boxcar and started moving the train. And indeed, as the train moved, a red line on the screen developed based on the position data received from the measuring car. I programmed the display field dynamically so it would change its scale whenever the train otherwise would move out of the active area. The train then moved through the curved section and the reported positions changed direction as well. Back in the other direction and the second curve, and the train arrived at the position where it started. And really surprising, the track trace on the display was pretty much showing a closed loop. Of course, I was excited, as you can imagine. Next, I set up a siding and had the train using it going back and forth. And indeed, the siding was clearly visible on the display. I then let the train run continuously for 6 or 7 laps, and this is the track record I got from that. As you can see, there is a small offset, but quite moderate. After seeing these results, I wanted to do a test on a larger and more complex layout. And since I was just about to leave for a trip to Europe, I packed the sensor and magnet and asked my old friend Beat from Switzerland if I could come by and run a similar test on his garden railroad layout, and he kindly agreed. So we installed the sensor on a flat car and mounted the magnet to the axle, and the GPS car was ready to go. His layout is loosely modeled after the Rätien Railway, a famous narrow gauge line in the eastern part of Switzerland. One of the landmark items of the layout's 200 feet main loop is a mirrored version of the famous Brusio spiral viaduct, where the train goes full circle and crosses over its own track. I thought that was pretty challenging for my sensor and would tell a lot about the quality of the recorded data. So enjoy the train ride over Beat's Bernina Line layout and watch in the screenshot how the traveled trajectory is reported and displayed. Thank you. After completion of the loop and stopping at the very same location, the position error was less than 1 foot, and that after a 200 feet travel, including some climbs and descents, and 2 full circles of turns. I then ran a second loop, and as you can see here, there was also a small offset in the direction, small enough though, that it can be corrected in software. Furthermore, the sensor I used for the test is already 3 or 4 years old and has some difficulties to calibrate itself. A newer version of the BNO055 sensor, which also has the latest Fusion software, is on order but did not make it in time for my travel. Very well possible that it will do better with the angle drift. We will see when it arrives. Overall, it really looks like this train-side sensor is working better than expected. So let's talk a little bit about the use cases I have in mind for it. My original motivation was creating a data input tool for the security element handler of the IoTT stick. If you watched some of the IoTT stick videos, you know that the SE handler is the logic module to handle signaling. To calculate and set signal aspects, the SE handler needs a track model with interlinked blocks, with occupancy feedback, and so on, as I have demonstrated in the Yellowhead Tricks video series. But of course, this is a lot of data and there is significant risk of data input errors, which then cause a lot of efforts for debugging and testing to make the signaling system work. So the idea is to use a train GPS to kind of learn the track layout, then allow the user to select areas of the layout where he wants to have, say, an ABS system in place. The web app can then identify the correct location of the signals, block detectors, etc., and automatically program the SE handler to support the ABS section. So that's my first use case, and that is what I will be working on next, and if you don't want to miss it, you should subscribe to the IoTT channel and hit the bell icon so that you are in a premium seat when new videos come out. But wait, there is more. Now that I have seen the accuracy that is possible with this train-side sensor, I am also thinking about an even more powerful use case. As before, the train-side sensor could be used to record a track geometry and set up the signaling system. But then, that track model could actually be shared with similar train-side sensors installed in the other trains. Once the trains have an onboard model of the track, they could monitor their current location on the layout and report it back, for example in the form of block occupancy and train identification messages. And since the track normally does not move, it would be possible to use the IMU to detect certain features like turnouts to periodically recalibrate the positioning system and compensate any possible sensor drift. Furthermore, these sensors could automatically monitor the aspects of signals they are approaching and adjust speed as needed. In other words, such a sensor could really act like an onboard train engineer, which would allow for a completely new way of doing layout automation. And since the train could report its current position, devices like current sensors and other trackside sensors would become obsolete, thereby simplifying layout wiring. Maybe just a dream, but I think well worth to put in more research efforts. And that's it for today's video. I hope this information was useful or at least interesting for you, and you have now some ideas how a train GPS could work. If so, please click the like button below to let me know and help to promote this video. And not only this video, but also the IoTT channel itself, because as you probably know, YouTube likes the likes. Thanks for watching and see you in the next video.